Okay, so as John said, he was talking about individual, if you wish, atoms. And he presented a whole series of different atoms. He presented characters, he presented words, compound words. So here I made a summary of a few of those items that we could think a document can be represented by. So we have also the character, we believe, the stem, prefixes, suffixes, declensions, word, compound word, a phrase, a sentence, section of a paragraph, and so on. You can imagine that you could have something else in between, you could have combinations, you can have just a group of characters that supposedly for somebody don't mean anything, but they might have another meaning for somebody else. So just sort of taking from John, we have atoms, but what do we do with them? So what we're really proposing is a sort of a document model that will have different parts to it. And so the first one, the easier to think about, is a sequence of these atoms, and that's what we call a galley. But one galley on its own, it's not very interesting. So we have thought of a mechanism of joining these galleys together, and that's what we call a list of links, or a link, simply. You can think of also algorithms to manipulate these galleys, transforming one into another. If we have a list of characters, we can produce a list of words, or if we have a list of words, can we provide a list of sentences? Parsing from input to the galley. So if we have an editor, I want to be able to take that input and put it into a galley that I want to use for a specific algorithm later on. And then obviously taking it out from that storage and put it into an output form, whatever I decide my output form should be. And obviously input and output mechanisms. So, let's talk a little bit about galleys and how do we might think of them. So here I just have a very, you know, simple sort of string of characters. And we actually have here, we can see two galleys. If we first look at the left side. My left side, is the W81, W82. So we can think of a galley that has words, and they are indexed by W81, W82, W83. To the right side, we can have another galley that is just representing characters. Okay? And for now, we just think of them like having just these two different representations. So an example link would be what? So if we go back, we have the last bit of the word cranberry has indexed from 228 to 232. So we can just sort of grab that range and say, I want to have all this range linked to a function, g of c, where I can say that g of c is colored blue. So this is what we can say is, in other words, markup. I'm marking up that section of my galley to be printed in blue in my output, okay? But you can imagine that that function can be anything. Another example of multiple galleys, you can imagine that this could have any script that just wasn't quite easy at that moment. We have three separate word galleys in three different languages. And arbitrarily, we have indices for each of the words. So this came about when we were thinking that how could we easily think of printing parallel text in different languages? So how are we going to be able to match? Okay, I want, without having to be dealing with translation itself. Well, I have this first paragraph and I want this whole paragraph to match in Spanish with this other whole paragraph in another language, and this awful paragraph in another language. So having this list of words which have indexes for each of the words, Then we just create a tuple in which we say that first tuple, the beginning of that tuple, of this region should match the beginning of that one and the beginning of that one, and the same thing for the edge. And you can imagine the algorithm being able to say, okay, I know that I have to typeset these three chunks of text next to each other in a specific area of my visual extract. And this is just a supposed output that we can imagine that up to this point of that part, all the three parameters have been up at that point. And that would apply, especially if you have a screen that you could imagine having the things that are next to each other and that they are matching visually. So that brings us to something. What happens, we have several galleys. In the previous example, all the galleys were sort of at the same level. But what happens when we have the main galley of being just text, but we also have another galley which has the footnotes, and we also have another galley that has the markup, like the functions that of color that I mentioned before. So these have to be interleaving. We have to find mechanisms to being able to point from one to another. The reason why we put them separate is because we want to be able to say, usually marginal nodes or critical nodes are not considered part of the matrix. If you're doing some sort of search, you want to be able to differentiate it too. So, we could also have tables the way John mentioned them, that they just be a tuple, and that could be another galley that gets inserted somewhere. So now we have this pointers to the main galleys, which John talked about being the iterators, and that's how we would manipulate this sort of ranges. So what are these lists of links? Well, they would be represented by tuples. They could be a point or a region. And since we could have separate lists of these links, they can be overlapping. They can be nested or overlapping. So that's probably what John was thinking about for your question about music. You can have one galley representing one sort of linear, in time, and then having another one which overlaps in another time frame, if you wish. You have a marker equivalence between galleys, which is what we're doing with the paragraphs. Many things. So this is an example about a very simple word. We have the word for mammals, and we have how we can have three different pointings representing three different places in the word. So if we have a pointer, if we have the range 3.3, that means that's the division between the root and the termination of the word. And so on for syllable 3, it's just the root. And that's just to show that we can represent absolutely any point in this stream of characters, any point or any region that we wish to. And we can tag it in our galley. If we have just roots or something like that, we can just say, okay, this is one root, this is another one, and have specific descriptions for each of them. So, this is just really much brainstorming what sort of algorithms we can think of applying to this galley. Well, this is an infinite list. We can do, we could imagine doing any of this at any time. Line numbering for typeset text, for example. We can have one galley and convert it into another galley. Panel text. We can imagine being able to use a very flexible range of algorithms. So, and the output is the same, but the output given, just the algorithm. What is really, really, really important here is that the storage of the galleys, the data structure of the galley be flexible enough for the algorithms to be able to manipulate them and to be able to manipulate new galleys as is needed. And those are the end comments of the model. This is just it would be so much flexible than anything that we could imagine seeing. And the key point is really the design of these data structures in the galley mode, having this link atoms representing different things of a text. That's it. Any questions? Any comments for us?
Yeah. When you speak about synchronization between galleys, it obviously means different things for different kinds of galleys. For example, if you have audio and visual streams, your synchronization means temporal in the same time. But when we speak about typesetting, it's completely different things. It means maybe on the same places, on different pages, or in the different. So you, I think that in your model, you need to have some, besides the general term synchronization, you need some instances. What do you mean by synchronization for any kind of galley, right?
Yes, this is at this point is more of an abstract model that once you start going down into the specifics, then we start applying what you just said. Yes, this will be just time. Yes, this will just be position.
Mm-hmm.
Synchronization in position. Yes, exactly.
My impression of perhaps different kinds of galleys. You have those which can be derived by transformation from others, and you have those which you would absolutely have to keep because persistently, because they are essential to keeping the semantics of everything. So probably there should be kind of classification or something to indicate.
I think that's what applies what John said about certain representations would have a canonical representation of their text, and that would be their like base,
mm-hmm.
and everything would be derived from them. But somebody else might have another
mm-hmm.
base that they want to keep as their canonical, that would just keep all the models. Yeah.
One has to be very careful to throw away representations. I have seen that in certain research projects, people have thrown away representations on how it was put into old books, and they were credited guilty afterwards.
Yeah.
You see how far the margins were bad. These simple things as how wide the margins were something important
mm-hmm.
for cultural research.
So what you're saying is, with any form of input into the system,
yeah.
we have to be honest.
In the end, yes, yeah.
Mm. You don't know what the semantics are going to be.
Yeah. Oh, but you don't know what kind of questions people are going to ask on your stuff. So there's something that you might see as something derived and you don't care for it. And suddenly some historical research person comes across and wants to research, well, how far interval spacing is because you're doing research on typographical traditions. And suddenly he's interested in, well, here we have narrow typesetting and here we have wide typesetting and how it changes over the years. And so normally you would say a plane or white space as to just turn on the, not just get the discussion between you and Jonathan before. It's not relevant, but it might be relevant in the context of research of tradition of typography.